when you're in the middle of it and it's just going on around you, you don't realize how special it is in a way.
It's only later on you kind of realize, oh, I can't believe I was in such a special situation.
I know. And you look back, and I was just too young really to get it, I think. But I was very fortunate. But I struggled a lot, too. I mean, when I first got out of Juilliard, I was in a group called the Acting Company, which is a national touring classical repertory company. And it's a real, what we call a bus and truck. You're living out of a bus, and all the sets are in a truck, and lots of one-night stands. And it's very, very grueling. And I played Edgar in Lear, and a whole production of Mother Courage. I was Eilif. But after that, I really had a year of just, you know, struggling to get by in New York. Kelsey was too. Kelsey was broke before he got Frasier on Cheers. Robin was doing stand-up comedy mime work on the street outside the Metropolitan Museum over on the East Side. You know, everybody was just struggling to get by. And it was a fascinating time, actually. There was a great, if you can imagine this, kind of an innocence about New York then, even though it was a gritty period in the city. You know, my first apartment I was paying $100 a month for. You could still find that on the West Side. I was a full scholarship student at Juilliard. They don't do that anymore, I don't think. I think you have to get grants now. So was Kelsey. So was Robin. We were all full scholarship. So in a way, it was a more innocent time.
When you actually landed the role of Bruce Wayne and Batman for the animated series, did you know what voices you had for those characters going in? Or was it something that the producers were talking to you about, say, oh, try this, or try this?
No, actually, I came up with the sound during the audition. That's why I said it was just kind of a lucky coincidence with my background in the theater. And then they described the character. They said, okay, well, use your imagination. He's confined to a cave. It's kind of a self-inflicted exile. He's tortured by the death of his parents. He leaves the secret of life. He's misunderstood. And I said, well, you're describing Hamlet. And they said, well, no one's made that analogy. And I said, well, let me just use my imagination. And as I put myself into that dark space, I just went into a darker and darker place in my voice and a huskier sound to make it a more mysterious sound. And then it just evolved. And as I was doing the sound, using my imagination to do it, I saw them in the booth kind of running around. And I thought, well, either I've done something really bad or really good because they're reacting in there. And interestingly, in the early episodes, they let me do a very different voice for Bruce Wayne than from Batman. It was a distinctly much more urbane and sophisticated, a lot of humor, a lot of wry kind of takes on lines. They let me really play with it, and I had a lot of fun doing that. And then after they did the mixing of the first few episodes, they realized they wanted to take the show in a much darker direction. So we went back and we remixed the early episodes to take down the Bruce Wayne character. But initially, there was a very clear distinction between the two, which I thought was kind of fun. And as actors, you know, you're always looking for ways to make roles more interesting. But in the evolution, they wanted him to be a lot closer to Batman so that the vocal distinctions were much less.
I guess you said that since your only experience really with Batman was the, you know, the Adam West series, was it at all difficult to find that, you know, being so used to Adam West's portrayal of it, which is kind of cheesy, over the top, instead of like the comics, which is a lot more sort of realistic?
Well, once I got the job, I looked into the Dark Knight comics and I realized what they were doing. I mean, this is a really noir comic and it's beautifully conceived. So the Adam West thing was a real departure from the Batman legend. So I realized what they meant when they said, oh, no, don't go in that direction. And what's interesting is he came on the show to do the voice of Grey Ghost. He couldn't have been more gracious. He's such a charming, gracious guy. Because, you know, I was a little trepidatious. You know, you're kind of stepping on someone else's toes a little bit, doing a role that they established their name with. And he couldn't have been nicer. He was terrific as the voice of the Grey Ghost, too.
He's got such a voice for voice acting. You know, he made his start in Batman. But, I mean, since then he's done Family Guy as well, and he's absolutely terrific.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, since you're a theater actor, was it really challenging to make that inevitable switch from live acting to voice acting? I know we discussed this a little bit, but was it difficult sort of on your end when you were going into this project?
No. You have to be really flexible in this business to go in a lot of different directions. I think when I was starting out, people either did theater or they did television or they did film. I know in London, that's not the case. In England, it's always been the case that people always did everything because everything tends to be based around London. But in the States, it's divided between LA and New York. So there was always a real clean distinction between LA actors and New York actors, and people didn't go back and forth as much. Now everyone does. I mean, you can't confine yourself to anything. The business changed dramatically, and a lot of it was just economic because you can't make a living in the theater exclusively. You have to do television and film. So everyone has to be as flexible as they can be. I loved the fact that they wrote an episode where I could sing because I had been a singer and I never had an opportunity to really use it. I only used it in one play. And so they wrote an episode where Batman sang. So you have to be able to do everything.
Yeah. Oh, it wasn't a bad job, actually. I really enjoyed it.
Thank you. Thank you.
One of the questions that I actually had put in is, could we see a Kevin Conroy album, Batman?
That's not in the works.
Now, I guess when doing the role, is there any preparation you can do to get into the mindset of Bruce Wayne or Batman? Or is it very much something you can switch on and off? Because I know some actors kind of have to get into that mind frame before they do it, whereas other actors can kind of just go in there and get it done.
That's the thing about the technical aspect of doing voice work. You really can't indulge yourself an awful lot because there's technically so much to take into consideration. You can't go into some other world to get into the character. You have to be very much a part of the recording studio. So you have to be able to jump in and out of character pretty easily. And that's the difference with stage acting and voice work. Because on stage, you really can kind of get lost in the character and in the world you're working in. And in the recording studio, you can't. An interesting example is Mark Hamill, who you probably know does the voice of the Joker. And to watch Mark work, he literally transforms physically when he does the Joker. And it looks like he's going to devour the microphone. His voice, his face becomes so animated. He almost looks carnivorous. His mouth gets bigger than seems humanly possible. It's very interesting to watch. And yet, when they say, no, Mark, pull back, he can immediately break and get back into it and pull back. Or, no, we need another take. You overlap that line. It's so interesting to watch him because he can so go into the character and so pull himself back out so easily. And that's what you have to be able to do in a recording studio. You have to be able to get in and out really quickly because there's so many takes you have to make, you know.
Because Mark Hamill joined the cast and he made this new career for himself with voice acting, as unfortunately he was initially typecast after Star Wars. I mean, what has been your experience of working with him?
Oh, he's a terrific guy. He's very easy to work with. He's got an amazing collection of animation cells and first edition comic books and stuff like that. He's a real collector. So he's much more of an authority on animation than I am. He actually wrote an animated series that was put into production. I don't know whatever happened to it. I don't think it lasted very long. But he's a very multifaceted guy. He would love to, I think, do more writing and directing in this area. He's a very talented guy. He's kind of a Renaissance man. He's got lots of different things going at once.
Was it surprising to you that because he was known as Luke Skywalker and then he suddenly come into voice acting? I mean, was there a kind of thing of, what? He's coming into this? I mean, how surprising was it? Or did you kind of know him a little bit before? Or?
I didn't know him before at all. And I only knew him from Star Wars. So I didn't know, you know, what had happened to him in the interim or why, what led him to. I've never really asked him what led him into animation. But one thing, it's a very brutal business, the entertainment business. You're lucky to make a living at all. And it's pretty easy to say 80% of actors never work. I think it's something like that. The Screen Actors Guild is something like 80% unemployed. Of that 20% of work, maybe 5% make a good living. And of the 5% who make a good living, maybe 1% will last past their 30s. It's a very youth-oriented business. Very few people make it past their 40s. So to be in your 50s and still having a lucrative career in this business is pretty unusual. So for Mark, who's in his 50s, I think it's an inevitability that you ultimately have to start looking at other ways.